Welcome to Wicked Yankee Laughs. I'm your host for today's podcast, Bucky Lewis, with my special co-host, Tom Hayes. Tom, how are you?
I'm great. A little windy day, but we're winding down March and April's around the corner.
Well, three guys are sitting on a porch. Old guys. This is important. And one of them says the other one, rocking chairs. And one says, windy, ain't it? The other one says, no, it's Thursday. And the third one says, me too. Let's get something to drink. I'm looking forward to this week because it's about comedy duos. We did that last week, but this week it's comedy duos, female and male, which is a very curious dichotomy that we're going into here.
Yeah, you know, we're going to skate right over the thin ice.
Folks, if you don't know Tom by now, that means that he's holding his tongue. He's holding his tongue.
Biting his tongue.
He's biting his tongue on stuff. This week, it's no exception with some of the great clips of the comedy duos, mostly on television. And they were on television because television back then in the 50s, 60s, 70s wanted to go into, they found a gold mine in working with a couple relationship, right, Tom?
Yeah, absolutely. Great times. Even today, a little bit. I think Roseanne was probably the last one, right?
I don't know. I think Roseanne, that's a good point. No, I don't think it's the last one. I think that they always come up with something like that. I mean, from everything from Everybody Loves Raymond to King of Queens, that kind of thing. But we're going to start with, I think, the one that really catapulted everybody, which was All in the Family. And we selected this one. Let's share with our viewers a gem with...
Absolutely.
All right, here we go.
Don't go on.
It was in Los Angeles on account of they lived in California.
On she goes.
Anyway, one night, Franklin, that was the dog, he was whining and howling, which was his way of warning his master, who was my Uncle Sport, that there was going to be an earthquake. So my Uncle Sport, he put on his robe and his pony shoes, and he ran out of the building just as it started to shake. Well, everybody that stayed in the building was very safe, including the dog Franklin, but my uncle, well, he got hurt because a sign fell on his head, and the sign said, stay indoors in case of earthquake. Franklin the dog didn't even know how to leave, but he was smart enough to stay indoors. Oh, Dad, don't.
I would rather croak and hear you tell any more dog stories. I'm fed up to hear with dogs.
Oh, I'll never forget it. I was at the Puritan made ice cream.
Don't make it a long story.
Me and my cousin Maud was having one of their specials. It was called a steamboat. Oh, it was so delicious. Five different flavors. She was sitting at another table with that fella Jefferson Pratt. Remember him? Anyway, Archie was trying to get my attention. So first he put two straws in his mouth like a walrus. Yeah, and then we'll have a little fun, and we can keep it for paying bills and for trips to see Mike and Glory and little Joey. And then it'll be for presents for little Joey, too. Let me see, $5 a week, 52 weeks in the year, 5 times 52, 5 times 260 a year, that's all. Yeah, now let me see, how many years would that take me? Well, it'll be between 3 and 4 years. But all that time, on. You don't have to be paying me the $1 a week that I always listen to me, or I'll have to explain it to you all over again. See, you don't have to pay me the $1 a week.
You know, his pantomiming, that whole thing with the...
How much of that do you think was improv?
I imagine so. I mean, but I would imagine that he really, really practiced that stuff in front of a mirror to get it right. I mean, it was the whole, you know, and I it looked as though one of his eyes was even twisted. And the other one looked straight. I don't know how he did that, you know, but and she was marvelous. She just played her role with imagine. I wonder how many takes they did with her cracking up.
She was really the comedian, right?
Oh, fabulous. Yeah. But yeah. Then again, I mean, he just exercised amazing comedy antics right there. You know, his I think, you know, and when I, you know, we talked beforehand about why it's funny. I think, and especially in those days, even probably today, everybody had either a mother and father like that or an aunt and an uncle, right?
Right. It's a blue collar relationship. That the next clip we're going to watch is the same kind of ditziness that a woman put out there. And we both know that when you create a ditziness or a fact that you have an aura of being dumb, you're really actually smart.
Right? Oh, absolutely.
And this is what Gracie Allen was with George Burns. So let's watch this great clip from George Burns and Gracie Allen.
The George Burns and Gracie Allen Show in color.
Goodbye.
Who's on the phone there?
Jack Hellman. I understand you're giving a television party tonight, and you phoned him and Leo Guild and told them that I didn't want him to come.
Oh, yes. Well, Harry Von Zell said that that's what you wanted.
Misunderstanding.
Well, naturally, Harry Von Zell never gets anything right.
Naturally. Anyway, they're coming. I put the television set in the living room because I don't want Hellman and Gil disturbed. So give me the names of these people you invited. I'll phone them and tell them to stay home.
All right. Well, now let me see. First there was Mrs. Brown. Oh, you love her.
Mrs. Brown, she was first.
Well, no, she wasn't exactly first. She was about the 25th. But she was the first stranger I invited on the bus.
A stranger?
Yes. Well, of course, she's not exactly a stranger because I met her. So I really know her much better than the strangers I haven't met.
I'm sure you do. Let's get on with this list so I can call these people and tell them not to come.
All right, put Charlie Gibson down. I met him on the bus, too.
Charlie Gibson.
Well, I gave him one of my cards, but he wasn't sure he could be here. Oh, he was terribly disappointed. He said he wants to buy a new automobile, but his wife is expecting a baby any minute, and she said they can't afford it and talked him out of it.
Well, that would disappoint him.
Yes, he says he's even willing to settle for a second-hand one that's gone about 20,000 miles. So I said, well, I don't blame your wife. Any baby that's gone that far would probably be born with blisters on its feet.
Well, if you said that to Charlie, I don't think he'll be here. Who else?
Frank Shortnecker.
Frank Shortnecker. With two K's?
No, he's coming alone.
Serves me right.
So if a round-faced young man comes to the door with the ace of spades in his hand, that's Frank Shortnecker.
With the ace of spades?
Oh, well, I ran out of calling cards, but it was fortunate I had a gin rummy deck in my purse.
Who else did you invite?
Let's see. Oh, you you'll love the Three of Diamonds. That's Mrs. Klein. And the Seven of Clubs is Mr. Cunningham, and he's married to the Jack of Hearts. And then there was...
Gracie, how can I get in touch with these people?
Well, do what I did. Go to Martindale's bookstore with Blanche and then get on the bus.
Gracie, I don't know what they look like. I couldn't tell one from the other.
Oh, George, if you don't know the difference between Blanche Morton and a great big bus, you ought to have your eyes examined.
They were on radio for a long time before they got on television, and it was just a natural fit, the energy between the two of them.
You either have it or you don't. And you find that person that... you can do it with. And I always talk about Jim Henson and Frank Oz, that Henson, when I read his autobiography, he could do it with his wife, his first wife. And that's what got them started. They just had their brains synced on such a level. And then later on in life, it took him, imagine how many puppeteers and comedians and actors he went through. And then he and Frank Oz became Kermit and Miss Piggy, as well as, you know, I think Fonzie, et cetera. So it's just, no matter what characters they had that synchronization that's, I think, only God-given.
Well, Speaking of synchronization, our next clip is going to be on the Honeymooners, which is famous. And we'll talk about that in a second. But since you were talking about Frank Oz and Jim Henson, let's bring a clip on of Miss Piggy and Kermit, since we're talking about comedy duos who are male female, right? So let's bring that in right now.
Well, Miss Piggy appears angry.
Angry? No, I am not angry. Your star is not angry. She is merely disappointed.
Disappointed?
Yes. You have not been honest with me, Kermit.
I haven't?
No. When you told me we were spending a week in the swamp, You never said there would be snakes and spiders and alligators.
Well, no, I was saving the best part for a surprise.
Surprise? Kermit, you are out of your little green mind.
Well, gee, Miss Piggy, you know, I was born in the swamp. My roots are there, and I just wanted you and my other friends to see it. But we don't have to go back to the swamp. We can go to back where you were born. The sty. You know, where your roots are. Where pigs eat swill and wallow in the mud. Remember that? Huh?
That could not have happened without the relationship of two people together, right? I mean, isn't that what this week is about?
What I found beautiful about the book, I learned so much from that book about show business. And again, we talked about destiny, you know, and a lot of times we think we're supposed to think that we're the agents of our own lives and that we can map our own destiny. And here's Henson, who's in college, and all he wants to do, he sees television, the opportunity for television to become a set designer. And he's going on his own way. And all of a sudden, he sees the local TV station looking for somebody who can do puppets. And so he runs down to the school library, the university library, and gets this book on puppetry. And in fact, he studied this one great Russian puppeteer. And so because he was artistic in the sense that he wanted to do set designs, he started to build these puppets. And then he realized, well, I got to get into it. So with this opportunity to do a 5-minute show, he says to his wife, let's give it a go. They get the show, and they had that synchronicity, that ability to play off each other, and they created a sensation. And so now as the book unfolds, you find out he's gone through iteration after iteration, creating great characters. going through tons of puppeteers, tons of actors, and he and his wife broke up. He can only have that magic with Frank Oz. I mean, you're talking hundreds of people.
His partner. Yeah.
His partner, Frank Oz. And so a lot of times they didn't even script things. It was just off the cuff. So I think for the public, I don't think the public understands that. You know, you and I have found it with certain people. And when it does, it's heaven sent.
You talk about what we do with this comedy podcast, Tom, is to bring people backstage and to bring people into the green room and to sit in the green room with other funny comedians and just talk about conceptual stuff.
Yeah, well, you know, we talk about this a lot. The times when we break that fourth wall, how many times, Bucky, have you done on a show and you connect with somebody in the audience and somehow the two of you go off? You found, you know, your other voice that gets you and feeds you and then can give back. But again, very rare, but it does happen.
It does happen, and it's marvelous that it does. And we're going to go into probably the biggest, the most important, without a doubt, the most important sitcom with two people, a couple, that were trying to eke out a living was The Honeymooners, right? And so let's look at a great bit from The Honeymooners. At the time, it was well needed. It was right after World War II, people were trying to make a living. And this was the first sitcom that really Audrey Meadows didn't take any crap, right, from her husband. It was really groundbreaking. So let's watch this.
Just open your mouth.
Well, I want to say, Mrs. Wiedemeyer, that's very thoughtful. It's not many wives who want to give their husband something.
Oh, I don't know, Ralph. I've been thinking of giving you something. And you may get it real soon.
Isn't there any lot here?
Yeah, about 300 pounds.
Thing that he hasn't got, I got it here.
You got it here, and you got it here, and you got it here.
The bills will get bigger and bigger, and I'll get less to eat. I'll start losing weight. Then you know what I'll look like?
Yeah, a human being.
This is probably the biggest thing I ever got into.
The biggest thing you ever got into was your pants. You know something, right after you left the house this morning, I got in one of those silly moods of mine. You know how I get sometimes? So just for laughs, I thought, well, I'll do the breakfast dishes and make the beds and take the garbage down. Then when I came back up, I was still in such a funny mood. You know, I thought, why should I settle down to the drudgery of mending your socks? So I scrubbed the kitchen floor. Then, you know something, I was still so giddy and so gay over this whole thing that I thought I'd really enjoy myself, so I washed all the windows. Then, Ralph, I went out and I did the marketing, and I came back with a pot roast, and I put the pot roast on the stove, and while it was cooking, I went in and I cleaned out the bedroom closet. Now, I know that this may sound like work to you, Ralph, but it isn't. It's fun. It's such good sport. Do you know why it's such good sport, Ralph? Because I'm so loaded with modern conveniences. Just loaded steam irons and vacuum cleaners and dishwashers and washing machines, and say nothing of this lovely new modern refrigerator over here. Oh, that reminds me, it's time to defrost it. That will give you a rough idea, Ralph, of what a joy it is working around this apartment all day. You know why? Because it's so up to date. I am the only girl in town with an atomic kitchen. This place looks like Yucca Flats after the blast.
Don't you have certain names you like to call your husband?
Oh, I have
husband's outstanding feature and find a name that fits. Oh, I see. Isn't that a good idea, Tubby?
This is why our comedy podcasts are so cool, because we can distill down like they do in maple syrup, right? We can distill down and get rid of the water and get right to the sweet vinegar of it.
It was, oh my God, how classic. You know, I hope that every generation would experience that show. I mean, think of what she's saying. I mean, here we are coming, like you said, out of the war, out of the depression. Don't forget the depression preceded the war. Now we're getting prosperity after the war. And she's just nailing him. Oh, she's addressing the housework situation.
But this is why this is so important, Tom, for us to share this stuff with people, is because now, because of the COVID thing, people are kind of feeling the same kind of narrow, claustrophobic thing that's going on with couples. And our job, yours and mine, being both former motivational speakers, is to remind people you have to laugh, right? You have to laugh.
So healing. I mean, music heals. You do both. You do music and comedy. And I think, obviously, music, but there's nothing like a belly laugh. I have so many people. It's transformational.
It is. And you and I talk about this all the time, Tom, is that we're very lucky to be able to do this format, to share this with people. I think people really need this. I need this. You need this.
Well, you know, the thing that stood out in that clip was that whoever the writer was, the genius, look at that refrigerator over there. And here's the best part. She reaches for the pan. Because refrigerators weren't even defrostable. All the water ran down into the pan.
Well, you know, we can't leave a podcast like this without really addressing Lucille Ball and Desi.
Oh my
Arnaz,
God, that's great. Right? Oh.
And so this next clip is a very hilarious one, because you were talking about the refrigerator and you're talking about people who are trying to make it, right? And in a blue collar way, which gives a lot of us a sense of faith in where we can go if we do use humor and don't get so upset over little things.
Well, especially, you're exactly right. I mean, especially for a couple to get there, to realize, you know, how many times have we had arguments with our significant others and they break down? It's it really gets past the point where you just realize this is ridiculous. This is tension between
Tom, that's a great point we just made, because we sometimes batter the people we love the best with stupid stuff.
I wonder what that is.
Yeah, honey. Yeah,
butter. I always say I'm gonna get the butter.
Yeah, that's
Gee, honey, this never happened before, did it?
Never, never.
Hey, Fred, that's too bad.
Yeah, this is really a mess. It's a good thing we found out in time.
I'll say. Yeah. Found out in time for what?
I mean, before the deal went through.
What do you mean, before the deal went through?
Yeah. Well, I hope you don't think we're buying this piece of junk.
You already bought it.
I did not. No money changed hands.
You took possession of the merchandise. That's the same thing.
Yeah.
I told you we should have sold it to them.
You didn't.
Not much I did. You're going to pay me for this washing machine.
He is not. He is too. He is not.
He is too.
He is not. I mean, I am not.
You're not going to unload this lemon on us.
Lemon? Mira que tiene el coraje de decirle a uno ahora que no quiere comprar la máquina de lavar.
Yeah.
That's priceless. I mean, you wonder, you know, people join these dating sites, right? And they try to find some bottled magic. But this here, what we just watched, was bottled magic. Who would have thought that Lucy would have been this funny without Ricky, right? I mean,
oh, and the yeah. Yeah, standing up for her man.
Well, the reason that we selected all of these early clips on couples in sitcoms is because I just am impassioned because my first television show, I had a studio audience. We had, as you know, you were brought in to be part of my show. And we had 40, 50 people at a time laughing spontaneously. I think that's why Cheers was so good, because they always said at the beginning, a live studio audience, right? And that's kind of important.
Oh, yeah. You know, again, that fourth wall. But that gives you your, unlike canned, you know, it's genuine.
Right.
And you know, you're playing off, you're playing to that. You're
right.
Not just playing, you're playing to each other, but you're playing, we've got to interact in a way so that we get this. And there's, you know, a real sense of community. I mean, everybody's talking about COVID and the fact that the isolation and everything else, but that we know that every time that we've been in a show, what we look for is that sense of community. That,
well, we're going to end today, Tom, with, if we can get a message out there on what we do and how important we feel things are, is that when you do get down, folks, you have to look at, you know, God has made a safety valve. God has made a safety valve, not just masturbation. I guess I'm not going to put that in.
Well, you could just bleep it out.
But God has made a safety valve, and it's called humor, right? It's called humor, and that's what,
well, you know, you mentioned the motivational, inspirational part of our lives. I used to just say to people, you know, we live in a magic age where, why don't you do this, folks? There are thousands of 2 or 3 minute clips out there, like we just saw, which totally, I mean, people can see from what it just did to us. But, you know, flip one of those on 4 or 5, they get in a funk.
Well, no, more importantly, what they should do is follow us every week here on the comedy podcast.
Exactly.
Right. Okay. On Wicked Laughs. So with that, we're going to leave you folks with a small clip from the Addams Family. John Astin, who was Adams. He was the one that actually discovered Carol O'Connor. Right. Carol O'Connor. So we're going to leave you with this, folks. Tom, it's been enjoyable. I look forward to next week's show. We're probably going to go into the movies next week, and that will be very cool. So you folks out there, really keep laughing. Find a way to laugh and find a way to bring joy to other people. Thanks, Tom, for joining us here on Wicked Laughs on the shores of Lake Guttapee here in New Hampshire.
Great fun. This was a good show. I loved it.
Gotta go.
All right.
There we are now. Down you go. There we are. You see them yet?
No. Maybe they'll see us and come over.
I still think we should just have gone over and introduced ourselves.
Oh, darling, no, that's much too forward. This is better. Here they come.
Oh, how do you do? I'm Gomez Adams. This is my wife, Morticia.
How do you do?
Hubert Peterson, this is my wife, Amanda. We were just married.
Oh, how exciting.
You do that again.
Never mind the small talk. Find out what blew up.
Oh, yes. We were just wondering about those little explosions.
What explosions?
Those explosions. Oh, that must be Uncle Fester playing with his new dynamite caps. What?
He got them at the discount house. They're not up to par.
You mean there's so many exploding dynamite inside your house? Where else would he do it?
Well, see, you're washing your pup.
Oh, good heavens, that isn't a pup.
It's an octopus.
You have an octopus for a pet?
Oh, no. It's our son's pet.
Here, shake his tentacle.
Oh, take it away!
Darling, try it first.
Oh, I'm sorry. Excuse me. There we are.
He's really very friendly.
Come on,
Hubert, let's get out of here.
Yes, well, nice meeting you both.
Nice meeting you.
Seems like a nice chap.
She's a bit odd. A
little high-strung. It's a wedding day, new house. And Aristotle, you were very, very bashful. Oh, time to dry.
I had so hoped she'd be someone I could exchange recipes with. I do hope everything goes well tonight.
How can it fail, my dear? You're such a perfect hostess.
Darling.
And if the bridge gets dull, you can do your animal imitations. Do them now, Tish.
Oh, darling.
Please.
Very well.
Now the bullfrog, Tish. Bullfrog, it drives me wild. Let's not play cards tonight, Tish. I feel like honeymooning myself tonight.
Darling, you're so impetuous. Bridge first, bullfrog later. Isn't it a little late for Uncle Fester to be playing with his dynamite cat?
It's not dynamite. That was a gunshot. Came from the playroom. They should be along any minute now.
Oh, I do hope the new neighbors will like the house. Do you think they will?
How can they help it?
It is nice and dismal, isn't it?
Don't be modest, my dear. It's absolutely bleak.
Thank